perhaps these largely, perhaps negative narratives or narratives which tend to compare Europe with Asia. So we in Europe, you know, we are a peaceful, stable region, widespread democracies, whereas in the Asia Pacific, there are these, you know, very conflict-prone region. And I think that this negative, I will first look at why there is this perhaps negative perception and what are the opportunities in responding to your question. And so there has been a predominant focus on power dynamics when we talk about the Asia Pacific, especially if you compare with Europe, and most notably focus on the military buildup in the region and the hotspots that they exist, and the possible, you know, warlike scenarios in the Asia Pacific in the foreseeable future related to shifting power balance. And the second point, I have alluded to that, is that when we talk about the Asia Pacific, we really tend to compare with the European Union, with the European case, the security system, the security situation in Europe. And this is why when we compare with Europe, we tend to conclude that this is a more conflict-prone region, very unstable, you know, military buildup there, and possible war may, you know, happen in the midterm to long-term future. The region, however, has been really relatively stable since the 1990s. There has been no military conflict. Sure, as I have discussed in response to your previous questions, there are a number, what we call them, hotspots, sovereignty issues, geopolitical competition, energy competition, maritime tensions, but also historical and identity, so diplomatic issues, right? But there has been no really military confrontation in the region. Instead, very interesting, despite all these conflict tensions and unresolved issues, countries have been advancing with economic interdependence. More and more free trade agreements have been signed. We have right now a multilateral regional comprehensive economic partnership agreement, which is at the moment still in the process of negotiation, and there's a hope that it will be signed by the end of this year. Last year in November, India announced the withdrawal, so we have now in that regional comprehensive economic partnership the largest multilateral trade agreement in the Asia Pacific. We have the 10,000 members remaining, with Japan, China, South Korea, Australia, and New Zealand, so without India. But negotiations have been continuing. There has been a lot of cooperation on non-traditional security in the region. Pandemics, of course, the region has experienced SARS in 2002, then it was the bird flu in 2003, between 2003 and 2013. So certainly Asian countries have learned a lot of lessons from those, of course, pandemics that they were confronted back with, the SARS and the bird flu. And this is also one of the explanations why Asian countries have been broadly defined more successful than in Europe in responding and in flattening the curve much faster, and they have been a much, much, much lower mortality rate per capita in comparison to Europe or North America. So Europe and North America and the Americas generally account each for 40% of the infections that you have in comparison to, I think, 4 or 5% in Asia. So there has been a lot of cooperation on non-traditional security, also natural disasters, maritime cooperation, piracy, for example, back in the 2000s when there was a serious concern at the time with the piracy in the Malacca Strait, and other non-traditional security issues. I think that with this crisis, there is certainly more understanding, as I mentioned earlier, that East Asian countries or Asian Pacific countries have to take into their hands sort of their destiny. They have to establish regional, sub-regional mechanisms in order to deal with those issues, while of course not ignoring cooperation at the global level, but not entrusting sort of resolution of a number of issues to global or international organizations. I think the region has found its own way moving forward. We have indeed very high levels of economic growth. We have the largest consumer base in the region. We have a fast-growing middle class, changing demographics, very young population, in contrast to, let's say, the aging societies in Western Europe. Of course, not across the Asia-Pacific. You have South Korea and Japan. Countries really are struggling with aging societies. But you also have Southeast Asian and ASEAN, where we have really a lot of young people, a lot of babies, which is, of course, important workforce for the future. And there is widely expectation by scholars and observers that the Asia-Pacific may emerge much faster from the COVID-19 crisis than Europe, and perhaps may be a good example for Europe. We are kind of used to, when we talk about Europe-Asia relations, there is this tendency of looking at the European model and Franco-German reconciliation, how that should be applied to the Asia-Pacific, and how the European model is the model that has to be adopted and followed kind of, you know, around the world and especially in Asia. But perhaps now we have a lot to learn from the Asian countries, from their responses, from their thinking on pandemics, on other issues, and from their approaches to regional cooperation. And in terms of soft power, also I have been listening to a number, of course, of talks and discussions. There's almost every day now webinars or interviews. And I heard a very interesting comment made that in terms of soft power, it is perhaps now that Asia may be even become much more attractive. For example, Asian universities, Singapore, South Korea, Japan, Taiwan may become alternatives to North America or perhaps Western European universities that have been sort of traditionally popular or in the English-speaking countries, Australia, of course, New Zealand, the United States. And now, as we are emerging from the COVID-19 crisis, as many countries are embarking on deconfinement, on lifting up restrictions, there probably will remain certain concern about traveling and safety. And perhaps it is in Asia that many people will be much more comfortable, for example, traveling, studying, or looking for a job where indeed the infections have been much lower mortality rate than Western Europe or North America. So perhaps this is something that may be positive. One of the many, I can say, positive things about the Asia-Pacific region.